Good evening, and welcome to Quinteview. I'm Marcy Lavadiotis.
And I'm Tony Grace. On this episode of Quinteview, it's a hobby that's chugging down the tracks with full steam for many people in the Quinte region. We'll take a look at some local model railroad enthusiasts. And is it punk music? Is it alternative? Well, with a name like Fry That Boot, it promises to be something interesting.
And while some kids are horsing around, they're also learning about responsibility through the care of horses.
What type of hobby draws a group of people from as young as 12 to as old as 80? And if you're like some enthusiasts in the Quinte area, you can spend up to $20,000 on it. Lindsay Young now on why model railroads are more than just toys for those who are hooked.
In the 1800s, the railway was created and has proved to be one of the world's greatest inventions. Over 100 years later, the fascination and love for the locomotive remains. The intricate workings of the train has created a fascinating pastime for people of all ages all over the world. Here in Belleville, the Quinte Railway Club meet every Tuesday night in this building beside the Via train station. The Quinte Railway Club was established in 1995. Today there are 22 members ranging in age from as young as 12 to over 80 years old. The members work diligently at this hobby to constantly improve and expand their miniature railroad. Every detail is made to look as realistic as possible. Things such as proportionate sizes and realistic materials have to be taken into consideration. Buildings are painted to look worn by weather. Landscaping is done and is incredibly precise. There are even working crossing signals. The precision and accuracy of building model trains makes this pastime not just a hobby, but an art. The time and work involved in creating these railroads proves that patience is a virtue.
Oh yeah, you got to have a lot of patience. And sometimes patience gets a bit thin. So then you walk away from it, cool off, and come back. It isn't a 24-hour job, it's a hobby, you know. But a lot of people at the shows show a lot of interest in it. Now, just how much of it they take home with them is something else again, you know.
Participates in four shows a year. It's at these shows that model train clubs from all over Ontario display their works of art for model train enthusiasts and other club members to check out. This latest train show was held here in Belleville at Moira High School. Train displays packed the gymnasium and there was no shortage of people eager to check out the club's creations. The youngest member of the Quinte Railway Club was at the show, working on his layout in the beginning stages. He has spent months designing his set and is just starting the long process of making his ideas a reality.
Well, this so far I've been working about 4 months on. I'm gonna have it like back in like 60s time. A bunch of old wooden buildings, stuff like that. And a bunch of trestle bridges, stuff like that.
visitors can pick up just about everything related to this hobby at the show. Even videotapes of, you guessed it, trains.
A fellow by the name of Paul Barnes does all his own filming. He travels like all over. And he does his own narration off and on through the tapes to describe what's going on. But it's all actual footage, actual sounds. And if you watch this video, it's great for modeling, for like N-gauge or HO. Because some of the scenery, you can just, you know, it's beautiful with the trains on the trestles and in the canyons.
Yeah.
I have a HO layout that's 22 feet in length and about 9 feet wide in a room upstairs. And the room was specially built for this layout.
So you have a lot of money invested in this hobby then?
Oh yeah, yeah. I probably have over 20,000 invested in it, in modeling itself.
Really?
Well, getting things cleaned up with it.
This has to be one of the most creative hobbies around. So where do the inspirations and ideas come from?
A lot of it all depends on imagination. You know, what your imagination, if you can dream up these things, you see what you want. You get it in your mind's eye, and you try to scale it down to the scale that you're working. When you get time, you take a look in the magazines, and you get various ideas from there. And observing life. A layout is never done. It's never finished. You're always working at it.
How do you transport something like
this? Every Christmas, a train display depicting the Quinte Mall's merchants is featured at the mall. Members of Quinte Railway Club set it up and maintain the display that delights shoppers year after year.
Well, that belongs to the Merchants Association up at the mall. That's theirs. But we set it up for them and maintain it. Like every day, a member from the club goes up and checks on it, you see, make sure everything's okay. And if anybody's up there shopping, you know, when it isn't their time and they see something wrong, they go in and fix it.
Expensive hobby on a large scale, but by joining a club, the cost is shared among members, which allows them to be a part of extravagant creations at a fraction of the cost.
But the club buys a lot, you know, like we pay dues, and the club buys the various parts, things like that, and the people will bring their own equipment to run, you see. Like all the locomotives, the trains you saw here tonight, they were all owned by the individual.
You don't have to be a pro to join the club. It's a place where each member learns from the other and eventually perfects the art of model train building.
Well, we usually have people come down, but they get to know what the show is, you see, or they hear of us through word of mouth or whatever. And we ask them to come down about three Tuesday nights to see how we, you know, get to know the guys, what we do. If they like what they see, come on back, we'll give you an application form. You know, they just fill it in, and that's it. There's no screening or anything like that going on. List your likes and dislikes, and away you go.
Some make it, and some don't. People around Belleville think that Fry That Boot will be a success. And with a bass player who firmly believes pizza tastes better on Tuesdays, how can they not? Angela Stever has more on this musical sensation.
If I could describe the band in one word, it would be Dave.
Crazy or unpredictable. If I could describe Fry That Boot in one word, I would have to use two, which would be going, definitely going somewhere. So three words.
Noisy. Corrupt. Sacrilegious. Tight. Fun. Loud. Great rhythm. Entertaining.
I have a very musical family. My mom, my grandfather always played piano and sang in the church and stuff, and my mom, the same thing. She was actually the organist in our church. Whew, who cares? And we just had a, my dad's side wasn't very, but my mom's side was just so musical. My brother's really musical. He's in a band who's signed and everything, too. And she had a guitar. My mom's had a guitar since I remember, and I just got on it one day and started playing in it, and I liked it, so then kept going and been playing guitar for 8 years.
Probably like in grade 7, just like playing drums, so I just kept on doing it.
I've just always been interested in music and everything, and we started a band, and I guess it was my first band, and we just played together, jammed and stuff, so.
Fry That Boot met in their first year at Loyalist College. They started practicing in their room at residence and have since played in many bars in downtown Belleville, including Maxwell's, Copperfields, and the Bohemian Penguins. Like any band, they have dreams of making it big, and those who have seen them play believe the band could be very successful. So how did the name Fry That Boot come about?
We started off with subordinate kung fu maestros, and then shoe barn, which had good meaning to it, like what it meant to us, and then, but the name just got on our nerves. Actually, when we played our first show, when we were making flyers, and I said to the guy, just put Fry That Boot on it, like whatever. He wasn't even sure what our band name was. We were going to the name Shoe Barn for a while, and I'm like, just put Fry That Boot. And then it looked good on the flyer, and we're like, ah, it's got a nice ring to it, so that's why we kept it. And so we're hoping to get a 6-song demo, giving it to bars, handing it out. If they like your stuff, you get a lot more chances to play shows.
And you can send it to radio stations.
Yeah, record companies.
Get your song on the radio, that's the main thing. Get people to hear it, so you get more people at the show.
Yeah, we've learned that the main thing, the best way to get signed, make, 500 CDs or whatever, and once they're all sold, then show to a record company that you sold that many with little support. I mean, the fact that you sell that much with, like, let's say we sold it all in Montreal with no distributors, just by us, just by playing shows, it'll show a company that, you know, if they put their people into it, their money, and they're distributing it across and promotions for it, it's a lot different. We're going to take the summer off like a regular summer.
Word.
We all finish in like April or whatever, and we're going to work all summer, save up as much money as we can, and then we're going to move to Montreal, give it a couple of years or so, and just see how the band's going, work jobs on the side, and that's our plan for right now. And Montreal is pretty much the best place to get started in all of Canada for a band of our style. And there, everyone tells us we still sound good as a 3-piece. It's just I'd rather have a 4-piece, so it gives me more freedom. Gives a better sound, I think, in the end. And so we're just going to wait till we get to Montreal, and we'll get another guitarist there, because, you know, if we get someone here, they might not even be going with us. We'll have to start all over when we go there anyway, so.
Fry That Boot got their first gig at the Bohemian Penguin, a local bar in downtown Belleville. Owner of the bar, Bruce Morgan, says he loves when the band plays there and thinks they have a great outlook on their future.
I love them. They're a nice bunch of guys. They're not in it as much for the money, or they like what they do. They're having fun with it. They enjoy it. And that is more important, to have people who enjoy what they're doing entertaining here, rather than people who think it's a profession and a, you know, way of making money, because the fun and entertainment value are out of it, and it's more of a job than it is leisure.
You know, keep a good rapport with everyone, so at least they ask for us back, as long as we're not living in the streets. And, you know, if we leave a show and, you know, don't get paid, but it's okay, you know, I can live without it, whatever.
Like last year they were playing different music than they're playing this year, and I think their new music is much more marketable than the old stuff they were doing last, like prior to the summer, because I think it regrouped. They started a whole new band when they came back to September, and the new one is a lot more marketable than the last one. The last one was more skate punk orientated, and this one's more a little bit of mainstream, but this one is could definitely go somewhere. Yes,
I love them. I saw them at some bar in downtown Belleville about 2 weeks ago, and I was really impressed. The drummer and the bass player have a really good, solid sense of timekeeping, and which allows Dave Martell, who's the vocalist and the guitar player, to go crazy. To do, and I mean, what I'm saying is that they provide such a good backbeat and rhythm track for Dave that Dave can concentrate on the vocals, on the performance aspects of it. So they just need more experience. They need to play more. You have to be able to do the sacrifices. You have to pay your dues. It's all, you know, all of those cliches, but the talent's there, there's no doubt about it. It's just they've got to work their asses off.
I try and see them as often as possible. It's hard for me to see them because I'm a single mom, so it's hard to get a babysitter, but every chance I get, I try and go and see them. I think Fry That Boot could be really successful with the right person representing them because they're professional, I find, and they're really good. Like, they're talented.
Not bad. They're pretty good. First time I heard them. They've improved since. Drastically. Their writing is just excellent, the writing of the songs, and as a band together they're tight, and they're really tight now, and they do really well. I think they have a chance. I really do. Maybe just locally in Ontario or Quebec, or maybe nationally. I don't know about internationally, but I think there's definitely a potential for radio play in Canada anyway.
It wasn't the kind of music I was interested in playing full time. You know, it was two or three nights a week, and I had my other band, Katila, and wanted to do that, and just, it wasn't something I was willing to give 100% for. So I figured it was easiest that I not be grumpy and not sort of hold them down. I think they're really good. Dave Martell was an exceptional songwriter. And, you know, they all get along really, really well, which is the key thing for a band. You know, they're all friends. They all spend time together outside of their practice room. So that's really good. And I think if they get their fourth person who really clicks in with them, that's it for them. They're good.
Fry That Boot has taken Christmas off, but you can look forward to seeing them playing around town in the new year.
Your childhood was like that of many kids. Saturday mornings were usually spent with Scooby-Doo, the Smurfs, Flintstones, or Batman. Well, for some Quinte area children, TV is the last thing on their mind on Saturday mornings. They're getting a different type of wake-up call, one that's bringing them closer to nature and animals.
It's still dreary here on Saturday morning when most kids would be in their house watching Saturday morning cartoons, but we're here at Tanglewood Farm and Equestrian. Let's go inside and see what they're doing.
We had a lot of children that wanted more interaction with the horses, so instead of a one-hour lesson once a week, we decided to start Saturday morning camp, which runs for 2.5 hours every Saturday morning.
We were talking to the instructor at Tanglewood Farms about why they created a camp for kids.
It's to teach the children to learn how to care for the animal as well as ride it. And they learn about stable management, how to bandage the horse up. They learn how to interact with the horses and how to behave around them, and they develop their riding skill.
We get to ride and we learn a whole bunch of stuff instead of just riding and not learning anything about them. You get to learn how to take care of them better and you learn responsibility too.
We learn how to take care of the horses. We learn how to ride better, improve our riding skills. And we get to work with people who have been around horses for years and years.
Well, we look after the horses. I help teach the kids how to ride. We do pony rides, trail rides. We clean the barn. See if everything to do with horses.
I think they're one of the most graceful creatures on earth. They're beautiful. I love them. They give off an air to me. I don't know why. Just kind of weird.
Watching them enjoy riding and like succeeding at jumping and stuff. Watching them have fun.
I love riding. It's what I do best. And I don't know, I just really love it.
It's worthwhile. A number of benefits. It's 3 hours on a Saturday morning, roughly, and the children get out. They have a good time. They learn a number of different things. Overall, it's very good for kids.
I think it's a great program. It gets the kids out into the fresh air. The self-esteem level that my daughter has gotten from it is just amazing. She's learned so much just over a year that she's been here. It's fabulous.
Well, we put the program together because we had all those children that wanted more interaction. So Saturday morning seemed the best time. We had a bit of free time. So we put the 2.5 hours at that. We decided to put 2.5 hours for these kids at that point.
I think Jennifer is great. She's extremely knowledgeable. It amazes me how much she knows for her age, actually. She's very, very gentle with the children.
Now, Bethany, sit back, shoulders back, heels down. You aren't watching where you're going.
She can be strict, but overall, she's really nice. She's a really good instructor.
Wonderful person. She's very good with the children. She can adapt to an individual's needs and what sort of attention they require in order to learn how to deal with the animals, how to ride, all the various points of working with horses.
The parents like to see them improving and they like to see them involved in something that they want to be involved in, and it keeps them out of trouble, and they get to bring them here for 2.5 hours so they get some free time to themselves as well.
Okay, nice and easy, down to a walk. Sit.
I like it. It gives us a chance to be involved with the horses, and we get to learn how to do the barn work and stuff, and we also get to ride, so it's great.
Well, I think it's really fun because we get to spend time with horses instead of like just sitting at home and being a couch potato or stuff like that, and I enjoy coming here.
We were talking to Marge Mitchell about how the farm got started.
We've always been involved with horses ever since I was a teenager, and it's always been my ambition in life to have my own farm and a riding establishment like this. So we moved here and we've built it up over the years, gradually.
I get to spend time with my favorite animals. I love horses, and I like the people around the barn. They're happy.
We asked her what she thinks the kids get out of this camp.
Well, basically, I think to learn how to ride horses properly, to work around them safely, to have empathy with the animal as well, that's very important. A lot of children nowadays, they are very mechanically inclined. They work with TVs or VCRs or whatever, and they have no idea that an animal has feelings. And we try to instill that in them as well, that it is a living, breathing, thinking, feeling being that you're working with.
Well, that was our Saturday at Tanglewood Farms and Equestrian. The kids learn a lot, and I learn a lot too, and hey, maybe next time I'll get to go riding too. Look at you.
Well, a number of interesting events are on the menu here in the Quinte region over the next couple of weeks, Marcy.
That's right, Tony. Well, with Christmas just around the corner, why not come out and enjoy a Christmas musical, White Christmas? It's being presented by St. Paul's United Church Choir and Friends. It'll be held December 20th at 7:30 p.m. in Sterling. There will be a Christmas Eve family service at Bridge Street United Church on Friday, December 24th at 7 p.m. The service will focus on the birth of Jesus and will involve carols and a Christmas pageant by members of the congregation. There will also be communion and carols by candlelight starting at 10:30 p.m. Come out and enjoy Christmas crafts, stories, songs, and games at the children's services to be held on Wednesday, December 29th at the Belleville Public Library. And we mustn't forget about our bulls over the holiday season. They'll play the St. Mike's Majors at the Yardman on New Year's Day at 2 o'clock. Come out and support the bulls if the champagne doesn't get to you.
Well, that second story that we had on tonight's program about the band Fry That Boot, what an interesting name they had.
Isn't it interesting how all three of the guys' names in the band are named Dave?
Exactly. Well, I guess like every other band in the area, they'll be looking for gigs for New Year's Eve celebrations.
They'll be swinging into the holiday season, I guess.
That's right. And speaking of swinging, coming up on the next Quinteview, jump, jive, and wail, or at least learn how to do it first. Arlene Dowell will fill us in on all the buzz surrounding swing dancing. National award-winning hairstyles. No, not in Hollywood, but right here in Belleville. Rosemary Blockland will take a look at a Belleville hairdresser who has gained national recognition. And could that pampered pooch have a higher IQ than its master? Rob Arnold will have all the goods on just how smart some dogs are.
And that wraps up our edition of Quinteview. And just a reminder that this will be the last Quinteview episode of 1999. We'll be taking a few weeks off for the holiday season and then returning to air on January 17th. So from everyone here at Quinteview, we'd like to wish you all a safe and happy holiday season. And we'll see you in the new millennium.
Season's greetings and have a good night.
Good night.